Thank you all. Good evening to everybody. Thank you, Dr. Goswami, and all the dignitaries present here.
My pleasure, sir.
Yes, and also to Dean, Faculty of Engineering, Mathematics and Natural Sciences, University of Bengaluru, and also Dean, Faculty of Medical and Health Sciences. I think Rector, sir, is not around, madam. Vice Rector, Madam Goswami is here from Patkatila University, and she is also Associate Professor of Bengaluru University. And I am proud to announce today from Dr. Taruknath Memorial Foundation, we are arranging our beloved Dr. Mrs. Gita Talukdar Memorial Lecture, who is our supervisor of PhD, and we are going to listen afterwards from our youngest scholar, Dr. Rini Dostidar. So without wasting much time, I just want to show our one of the senior most student of Dr. Professor Gita Talukdar. She cannot join through this through Zoom meeting because of network problems, and so she sent the video of her speech. I am just sharing it.
It is my privilege to talk about Dr. Gita Talukdar. Today, I would like to talk some of my experience while working with Dr. Gita Talukdar. I joined her lab in the year 1982 and did my PhD in the year 1985. We were she always cared for her students, not only for their research work, but for their personal problem. She gave freedom for her students while working the research, and that helped me to be independent in the scientific research field. She was always ahead of her time, and she was the first person who did cytogenetics for the diagnosis of genetic diseases in our city. Nowadays, the term PCR is well known to all, but we did PCR in the year 1992 when I returned from USA with the training of PCR technique. We started PCR diagnosis of thalassemia, and that work was published in the journal Lancet the year 1997. She had more than 170 publications in different journals, international and national journals, and some of her students are doing research successfully all over the world. She was open to everyone and had smiling personality. I was moved by her personality and ingenuity of the scientific world. I left my permanent college teacher job and came to her lab. I am thankful to God for having the teacher like Dr. Gita Talukdar, Professor Rajana Sharma, and Dr. Gita Talukdar was not only my teacher, moreover she was my teacher, because teacher takes responsibility for your growth and makes you responsible for your growth.
Thank you. Dr. Madhusudan De, was the senior most scholar, one of the senior most scholar of Dr. Geeta Talukdar. And you have heard from her. She was professor of genetics. She has completed genetics, PhD on genetics on breast cancer, Dr. Madhusnata De. And she is still working in Ramakrishna Mission Seva Pratishthan, Vivekananda Institute of Medical Sciences as consultant geneticist. She handled first time Kolkata, they started the PCR. And we have learned PCR from them. So now I would like to request Dr. Ajanta Haldar, also present here. She is one of the my senior what you call research scholar, and also now professor of genetics and lab in charge of Vivekananda Institute of Medical Sciences, Ramakrishna Seva Pratishthan. So Dr. Ajanta Haldar, please. Ajanta Haldar, Ajanta Di, can unmute yourself.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes. So
okay.
I am good just evening. Sharing the screen and about Dr. Geeta Talukdar, she will speak.
Good evening.
Yes. Good evening.
Today I'm proud to say a few words about Dr. Geeta Talukdar, the doyen of human genetics in this part of the country. Dr. Geeta Talukdar was born in July 1936 in Pune, India. She completed her MBBS and MD in 1964 from Delhi University, India. She was awarded PhD in medicine in 1967 from University of Calcutta. She served Vivekananda Institute of Medical Sciences, Ramakrishna Mission Seva Pratishthan, and was dean from 1994 to 2000, and also having the post of senior consultant geneticist till last date. She was recipient of ICMR CSIR fellowship and 1973 went for training at Karolinska Institute Stockholm with WHO grant. She was instrumental in setting up thalassemia counseling and genetic lab in Kolkata, India. She has guided more than 20 PhD scholars. She served as task force on human genetics DBT 1995 to 2000, chairperson of DBT. She also scientific advisory committee member of cabinet government of India. Thank you.
Thank you, Ajanta Di, for your description. Just I want to share, she was, as Dr. Ajanta Haldar told, and also Madhusnata De told, that she is our guide and worked as a very senior position, professor and dean, and also scientific advisory committee, government of India. One thing I must tell, that as a in charge, we always see that she is the pioneer. She reached lab in of before of everybody. We reach always late than her. Even we try, we always jump through the stair. She coming by lift. So we try to go by staircase, that we should reach early and open the door of the lab. And sometimes only happen that we go fast. Always we enter lab, she is sitting on her chair with a cup of tea, reading the new, what you call the articles, etc., or working in the computer. So that way, she is the pioneer in thing, and that is the thing we have to know, that how a person personally can, what you call, influence all the people of the institute. So I would like to request our collaborator. I am from Lincoln University College. Is the giving us the platform to use the Zoom facility and also collaborating this event. And I would like to invite Professor Gurswarani to say a few words about this collaboration, because she is instrumental for making collaboration with Indonesia, and she is very helpful to and CR Pool also to make this event successful with, and she also make collaboration with Bengkulu University and Patpetilai both.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr.
Yeah. Thank you, madam. Please tell about your university and Indonesia something so that everybody will be aware.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you for giving me a chance to share this little bit about this our collaboration. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Dr. Sandeep. Good evening, Dr. Rinini, and also everyone from India and from Malaysia, and of course from everyone in Zoom and also on YouTube, from Indonesia, from Bengkulu, and also from Curup, from Patpetilai University. Thank you, Dr. Sandeep, for giving us to collaborate for the great event. This is for learning about something about this disease and also this vitamin D from, I think, from the great biochemist from India. So thank you also for the Dr. Rinini. And today, so we collaborate with two universities from Indonesia, from Patpetilai University and also from University of Bengkulu. So for special for University of Bengkulu, this is joined from Faculty of Medicine and Health Science, and also from Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences. I see here there's a lot of from University of Bengkulu participant, and also from Patpetilai University. Here also join with us the Dean of Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences, and also Professor Riwandi from Agriculture Faculty. Also, we have here Vice Dean for Students Affairs from University of Bengkulu, from Faculty of Agriculture. And you see here also the Head of Department of Biology, also from University of Bengkulu. And from some our colleges from from University of Bengkulu. Okay, so I think we just delivered our gratitude and also our thanks a lot to collaborate with the Lincoln, and also for the here the Memorial Foundation, Dr. Poder. Memorial Foundation, and I think we don't stop just until here. This is our collaboration for next time. Yeah, we really want to develop this our collaboration for the next event. So I think everyone can be fun to learn. Yeah, I think this really good lesson, good lecture from Dr. Rinini, and so. Accept this our greetings, our warmest greeting from Indonesia, especially from Bengkulu and from Curup. Thank you. Enjoy the lecture. Thank you, Dr. Sandeep. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, everybody. Yeah. I just also want to share that Dr. Taroknath Poddar was my grandfather, and we have not seen him. I have not seen. And when my father was in class 10, means SPM standard, then my grandfather expired. So, and he done research in 1937. He published a paper and on the parasites, and with his name, the parasite was named. In 1937, the paper was published. And that paper still is citing in this year, 2019 also, that name of the parasite and other papers, that 4-5 articles that time he published, that articles is still citing in 2019, the Web of Science catching the data. So that type of research-minded person was Dr. Taroknath Poddar, and you can see the link I have given, the website link of our foundation. And if you want, I can show you, but I think there is less of time. So I don't want to waste time. We are doing some activity, and also we have started one journal, International Journal of Advancement of Life Science Research, and Professor Goswarni is one of the editorial board members. He agreed to be along other international members. So our journal also running, and July issue also published. It is indexed in Google Scholar and also other index body. DOI also have. So that is our foundation. We are also doing some charity works and also organizing events, conference. Last December, we organized one event in Kolkata, international conference, 2017 and then 2019. And now this one webinar we are going to organize few, because now the new normal era, we have changed the means physical contact. We don't have to go anywhere, so we can learn more and we can participate and we can communicate. Like we meet Professor Gusswani and all of you, that deans and all these persons, we cannot meet physically before. Now it is very easy that we can get connected. Now we can see that Zoom meetings is full of 100 people and YouTube also more than 100 people watching at present. So without wasting much time, and there is also some participant like Miss Uli Fethi. She is from the, what do you call it? Science School of Health Science, Mandala, Indonesia. She is also present. I will call after the lecture. So now I just, everybody know about Rininib. In the poster you have seen, she was the youngest scholar on biochemistry, PhD biochemistry she have awarded from Ramakrishna Mission Seva Pratishthan under the guidance of Dr. Mrs. Geeta Talukdar. She, and now Rinini is presently working as associate professor and senior biochemist in the same institute. She was graduated in chemistry from India, Kolkata University of Calcutta in Bethune College. Then she have done post-graduation from University of Kolkata and then PhD. Then, and she has worked on DNA analysis in forensic lab in UK. After that, she started in as a student in the Ramakrishna Mission Seva Pratishthan. And after completing that, she has joined in that same institute after a few years of experience in other places. So without wasting much time, I call Dr. Rinini to share her slides and talk. Thank you, Dr. Rinini. Welcome. You unmute yourself, please.
One second.
Yes, yes, okay. We can hear.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Poddar, for inviting me.
Can you just make full screen this slideshow in the PPT screen?
I have made it.
Okay.
You get it? I have made the full screen.
No, it is showing slide view. You click on the PPT view, the down icon.
Click first, enable editing, sir.
Enable editing.
Upside.
No, Rinini have to do.
No, I have done it. I have done it this slideshow.
At top of the screen, you can see enable editing.
It's protect view.
It's not there. Enable editing, I'm not seeing.
Okay, you stop sharing, then you cannot see again. Wait, I stop sharing, then you can see. Then you start sharing.
Okay. Let me stop share.
I stop. You check. Now you check the screen and make it full screen first. Then start sharing. Because it is not enabled, the screen share, full screen.
So this is the full screen now. I have made it. Is it now okay?
Now share screen, please.
Oh, share screen. Share screen and put it there. This one. Okay. make it full view.
Click first, enable anything.
Is it okay?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. So let me start. Good evening, everybody. I feel extremely honored to be an invited speaker for the prestigious Professor Dr. Geeta Talukdar Memorial Lecture. For that, I thank Dr. Sandeep Poddar, our beloved Sandeep Da, and Professor Madhusnata De for providing me the opportunity to be present in this August event. Feeling a bit emotional at this moment. So many memories flooded in my mind. Many years have elapsed, even after her demise, but I can vividly remember the first day, the rainy afternoon, where I met her for the first time and expressed my desire to work under her. She was a renowned figure then, and she was a leading geneticist. She was a pioneer herself, an institution by herself in cytogenetics field and molecular diagnostics and various arena of clinical research. At that point of time, when I met her, she was doing work on hemoglobinopathies and thalassemias. So what I tell that her initial response to my request was not very much assertive, honestly speaking. So I got a bit disappointed, but all of a sudden she called me when I was about to leave. And she told me to come the next very day with all my credentials. My joy knew no bounds because I got the opportunity to work under her, such a stalwart in this field. It is needless to say, the next few years under her guidance was a smooth thing for me. I have learned so many things from her that I cannot count. It is countless. One thing I must share here on this platform, because what made her different from other guides, because she sent me to CCMB, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, a pioneer research institute in India. She sent me there. So this is very natural for a supervisor to send her student or his student to various places where they can learn. That is not big deal in that. But what made her different, because that time I was running out of fellowship, so she deposited money. At that point of time, it is 25,000. It was a big deal. So from her bank account, she deposited it to their account, to CCMB's account on behalf of me. And I was so moved by her, this kind of act, this kind of gesture. And I felt so much grateful to her because she wanted me to learn. That workshop was based on chromosomal and molecular diagnostics of various diseases. And when I came after learning from CCMB, I felt the pride on her face. That was a big thing for me. And the thing is that after getting my first job, when I repaid the whole amount to her, Didi, please take it. She took it, but she did not take it for herself. She donated it to the charitable organizations, the whole amount. That was her. She was so different. I'm so grateful to her, not only guiding me as a PhD guide, but I got unconditional love and support from her throughout my tenure. And after completing my PhD, whenever and wherever it is required, she was there for me. She left us in the year 2007. She's not with us. She's not with me. But I can tell the world that she resides in me. Maybe she will reside with me till my last breath. One thing I wish to share, that before coming to her, I joined the reputed institutes of Kolkata, Bush Institute and the Biophysics and Molecular Biology Department of Rajabaja Science College. Both of them were pioneered still. But anyhow, due to some personal reasons, my PhD dream did not get completed. So she hold my hand and lead me in a righteous way to reach my destination. She helped me to fulfill my dream for PhD. So thank you, Didi. I used to call my PhD guide, not only me, all the scholars, they used to call Professor Dr. Geeta Talukdar as Didi. So thank you, Didi. Thank you for everything, wherever you are. You are, be in peace, and I know you must have watched me in these events. Because of you, I am here today. Thank you, Didi, for being with me in my life, wherever and whenever I needed it the most. So thank you very much, everybody, for giving me this opportunity. Thanks a lot. Now I will come to my topic, which is a very, very pertinent topic, that is role of vitamin D in autoimmunity and with a special emphasis on Hashimoto thyroid disease. It is a autoimmune kind of disorders. So the thing is that vitamin D is a sunshine hormone. 90% of vitamin D is synthesized in our body internally and 10% comes from food. So it is all well-known fact. Why it is called hormone? Because it has the structural resemblance with many steroid hormones and it has the cholesterol as its precursor. Like hormones, this vitamin, fourth vitamin of the vitamin series, vitamin D is involved in almost all biochemical and metabolic pathways, and thus it fulfills the criteria of being a hormone. So that's why we consider vitamin D not only the fat-soluble nutrient, but also a hormone. So these are the known facts. I know most of the viewers know about vitamin D, but those who don't, a quick recapitulation for that. We know that exogenously we are obtained vitamin D by dairy products and fish oil. And endogenously, it is synthesized on our body in presence of the UV rays. So 7-dehydrocholesterol, I will come to my next slide. It's there on our skin and in presence of UV rays, especially UV B rays, it is getting synthesized. Vitamin D is renowned for its action for the absorption of calcium and maintaining bone mineral homeostasis. So calcitriol is the biologically active form of vitamin D. One thing before going to my next slides, so I should mention that I will concentrate on the vitamin D deficiency in the role of autoimmunity. So we should know that what are the deficiency level. So as per RDA 2012, it is when the serum concentration of vitamin D less than 20 ng per ml, the person is considered to be the vitamin D deficient. When it is 20 to 29, it is called insufficient. 30 to 100 is defined as sufficiency, and more than 100 ng per ml is considered the potential toxicity. So, but now here I'd like to mention, since 90% of the world's population are vitamin D deficient, so it is high time to reset the cutoff values of vitamin D deficiency. So there are various structures of vitamin D. These are big structures, cholesterol, 7-dehydrocholesterol. So you can see the big, big rings of the cholesterol moiety. Sources are very common for vitamin D. You can see from the pictures, the milk, the orange juices, the beef liver, cheese, egg yolks. Several supplements are there, cod liver oil, fatty fish, so many sources. You know we are taking every day, but still we are getting vitamin D deficient day by day. There might be another reason, so we'll discuss on that. So the activation, how it is getting activated. So it is there, 7-dehydrocholesterol is present on our skin, and argocalciferol that we are taking from dietary things. So both the argocalciferol and cholecalciferol or 7-dehydrocholesterol that is getting first hydroxylation into the liver. In presence of the enzyme 25-hydroxylase, there the first 25 hydroxy vitamin D is produced, and 25 hydroxy vitamin D is the determinator of the vitamin D status into our body. So 25 hydroxylase is the other name is the CYP27B. Second hydroxylation occurs in the kidney, and there the name of the enzyme responsible for double hydroxylation, the second hydroxylation, is that alpha 1 hydroxylase, that is CYP27B1. Then it is transformed into 1,25 dihydroxy vitamin D3, which is the active metabolite of vitamin D, and it has the tremendous power to exert its effects on various organs. So we are very much known about the endocrine functions of the vitamin D. As the picture shows that kidney, it is 1,25 dihydroxy vitamin D. It helps in the calcium homeostasis. Vitamin D is famous for its skeletal involvement. It helps in muscle health, bone health. It helps to regulate blood pressure. It helps to regulate cardiovascular health, neurodevelopment, etc. But it also exerts the paracrine and intercrine functions as well. So after hydroxylation in the liver, it traverses to the monocyte. There the second hydroxylation occurs. That is the 1,25 hydroxy vitamin D monocytes. As you know, monocytes and macrophages. These then, so vitamin D receptors are there in the monocytes and macrophages, and it helps in the immunomodulation. So immunomodulation is a very important part of vitamin D, though many people are still not aware of that. So it helps in the prevention of autoimmune diseases, and as well it helps in the control of invading pathogens. The vitamin D receptors are also demonstrated on prostate gland, breast, colon, lung, and keratinocytes. And their 1,25-dihydroxy vitamin D helps in this regulation of cell growth and differentiation. So we can say that cell growth and differentiation is regulated by also the 1,25-dihydroxy vitamin D, the metabolically active form of vitamin D, so it helps to regulate cancer as well. And many papers and studies are there, the role of vitamin D deficiency in the development of malignancy. So metabolism, this is a repeat slide, the last portion, you have a look on the last portion. That is, after hydroxylation, that is 1,25 dihydroxy vitamin D is produced, very fine. But you know, the body has its own mechanism so that we can get rid of potential toxicity by vitamin D. So in that cases, what happens, there are another enzyme that is CYP24 that causes the hydroxylation, 24-25 hydroxy vitamin D and 1,24-25 dihydroxy vitamin D, which is not so shown into slides, they are there lies the inactivation. So the body itself helps to, so that we can get rid of the potential vitamin D toxicity. So just coming on the metabolically active form, it helps the intestinal absorption of calcium, it helps the bone resorption, it decreases the renal calcium and phosphate excretion. So now coming directly to the vitamin D deficiency, which is the hot topic in India, and it is a known topic as well. Vitamin D deficiency, mostly underrated clinical condition. So nobody gives any importance to the vitamin D deficiency and says it's only a deficiency of the nutrient, because they are unaware of the tremendous consequences of the vitamin D deficiency. I will discuss in my later slides. So most common medical conditions, it was first pioneered by Dr. Michael Hollick. So he pioneered vitamin D research, and he told that the vitamin D deficiency should not be neglected and it should be given importance to delay the onset of many non-skeletal diseases. Autoimmune diseases is one of the non-skeletal diseases we will discuss. You know, 1 billion people, Now I think more than 1 billion people, 90% of world's population have vitamin D deficiency. It has been reported in everywhere of the world, nothing new in that, Canada, Norway, US, China, many other places. Recent prevalence of vitamin D deficiency in India is 80 to 90%. So you can easily imagine that when you will go through the consequences of vitamin D deficiency, how it is important to look into the vitamin D deficiency. So we did a study in the West Bengal population. How much West Bengal population are vitamin D deficient? It was basically a population-based study. So we get, in the year 2016, we did it, and we got 87.2% of the vitamin D deficiency was prevalent in West Bengal. There are various causes that causes the vitamin D deficiency. It might be the vitamin D's impaired availability, that is the secosteroid is not available. It might be the person might not get adequate exposure to sun. It might be the seasonal thing, because we know that seasonal variation of the serum concentration of vitamin D is very much demonstrated. In the winter, vitamin D concentration usually drops. It might be there are some conditions, that is that the malabsorption of fat occurs. So if the malabsorption of fat occurs, then it ultimately leads to the vitamin D deficiency, just like celiac disease, Crohn disease, etc. There might be the impairment of the hydroxylase enzyme, which causes the hydroxylation in the liver. So if the concentration of the vitamin 25 hydroxy vitamin D is decreasing, so naturally the precursor, if it is decreasing, so the next step will not occur. So there will be the deficiency. Similarly, if there is a, it might be the mutation into the enzyme that causes the hydroxylation in the kidney. So if the is there is an impaired hydroxylation in the kidney, so there will be the deficiency in the 125 hydroxy vitamin D. So there is a chances of causing vitamin D deficiency. Though it's rare, but there are some persons, especially the children, they are getting vitamin D resistant rickets. So then if you treat the children or the persons with the vitamin D supplementations, they get unresponsive to that. If a person's glucocorticoids on the prolonged time, so it inhibits intestinal vitamin D calcium absorption. I will discuss vitamin D polymorphisms as one of the potential causes of vitamin D deficiency. Why it is? Because there is a SNP, single nucleotide polymorphism, in the vitamin D receptor gene. And if there is a mutations in the gene, that will ultimately cause the vitamin D deficiency, because despite availability of the vitamin D, no problem of vitamin D production. But the thing is that it is not getting transported due to the unavailability of the receptors. So these are the causes. So you have a look in this picture. So you see the consequences starting from the brain to leg. So we did it in 2017. We published a paper in the European Journal of Pharmaceutical and Medical Research. So there we focused on the role of vitamin D deficiency in the non-skeletal diseases. And you see there are all non-skeletal diseases, schizophrenia, depression, upper respiratory tract infections. So there are so many autoimmune diseases, type 1 diabetes. It is multiple sclerosis, it is rheumatoid arthritis, there are so much malabsorption diseases, Crohn's, Whipple's, cystic fibrosis, so which is not there. So many hepatic failure, renal diseases, so many diseases are there. So the thing is that what this we studied and we published, you see, just have a look. I'm going not going into details because it will take time. If you can have a look in the slide, you can easily understand that how much vitamin D the non-skeletal persons have. So all of them showed that less than 20, that is, they showed the severe insufficiency vitamin D. And eventually, these persons all have these diseases, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, PCOA, CVD, TB, CVA. So we did a study conducted on 2700 vitamin D deficient people in West Bengal, and we got this. So now coming directly to the autoimmunity, concept of autoimmunity. So what is autoimmunity? When the system fails to discriminate the self and non-self, which is self-antigen and which is non-self-antigen. When your body fails to discriminate these two, then autoimmunity develops and it mistakenly attacks its own self antigens. So autoimmunity is that. That is, autoimmunity is the failure of organism in recognizing its own constituent parts as non-self. They think their self antigens as the non-self antigens and elicit autoimmune response against its own cells and the dangerous consequences. There are multiple autoimmune causes that lead to autoimmunity. Preliminary, the genetic disposition is there, predisposition, that is the MHC2, major histocompatibility 2, MHC allele, there this DR antigen and DQ antigen. So these are mainly, so the genes coding DR and DQ antigens are mostly susceptible alleles for causes autoimmunity. And there are some these immune regulation and the environmental factors. Here I need to know, so you can have the genetic factors is HLA-DR, DQ8 and CTLA-4, they are MHC genes. There are many genes others. Environmental factors, infections, stress, pollution, gluten, iodine intake, so they are environmental factors and endogenous, so many factors. I will discuss only on vitamin D deficiency because of shortage of time. So the most important concept of autoimmunity is that if a person is genetically predisposed and if environmental exposure to that genetically predisposed person triggers autoimmunity. So it's not that any persons who are not genetically predisposed, there is a little chance, or I can say a lower chance of developing autoimmunity, but if the person is genetically predisposed, they are highly likely to develop this autoimmunity. That is the magic of the gene interplay with the environmental factors. So we have a look of the autoimmune diseases, nothing much to say, so many autoimmune diseases. You can pick any organ. You can pick an organ, any organ of your body that can develop autoimmune diseases. So you never know which part of the body will elicit immune response of its own constituents. You never know. So now immune regulation. So as you all know from our childhood days, we know that there are two parts of immunity. One is innate immunity and one is acquired immunity. So any defect, a defect in any of these arm of this immune system can trigger autoimmunity. So acquired immunity or adaptive immunity. So there are two things. You know that cell-mediated immunity conferred by the T cells and humoral immunity that is elicited by the B cells. So now this is a slide. I will depict it in my next slide because that is a pictorial depiction. It will be easier for the audience to get it. So you just have a look on that. I have put vitamin D in the center. So it has the tremendous role on both arms of immunity. It is innate immunity and it is adaptive immunity. Both parts are there. What happens that it, let us first discuss the innate immunity. How it influences the innate immunity. You know that innate immunity is the first line defense of any immune deficiency. So it decreases the antimicrobial activity of the phagocytes. So you know the components of the innate immunity is that neutrophil and these phagocytes, monocytes. So it increases the antimicrobial activity of the differentiated monocytes and phagocytes. How? By secreting or by producing CAMP, cathelicidin antimicrobial peptide or defense inhibitor. So they secrete these chemicals and that destroy the pathogen. How it clears the pathogen? By chemotaxis or by phagocytosis. So I'm not going into details of the phagocytosis and chemotaxis because these are the very common and very, you know that, everybody knows that. So I'm not going into detail. Now what I tell that vitamin D also has the immune tolerance mechanism towards its self antigen. That's why when the deficiency of the vitamin D occurs, it develops the autoimmunity because it promotes or it modulates the self tolerance. How? So adaptive immunity, it decreases the pro-inflammatory cytokines, that is IL-6 and TNF-alpha. So it decreases the secretion of these pro-inflammatory cytokines by the T cells. What he did, vitamin D also increases the B cell apoptosis. So the antibody production will not happen because we know that Humoral immunity also plays a part in autoimmunity development. So if there is a clonal selection, if B cells is getting multiplied, so there is a high chance of getting more antibodies. But if the B cells getting apoptotized, so in that case, this antibody production will be low. So that is a marvelous mechanism. Contributed by vitamin D. What it does, it decreases the T cell cytotoxic activity by decreasing the FASL, that is the ligand, FAST ligand expression. It modulates the CD4 helper T cells differentiation by decreasing the TH1 and TH17. So these are the subset of the T helper cells. But let me tell you, these are the cytotoxic. So they will create the cytokines. The other important thing, it induces the trait differentiation. That is the suppressor immune tolerance gene and increases the IL tail and TGF beta. And most of the cases, say in case of the Hashimoto, I will discuss, it changes the TH1, that is cytotoxic phenotype, to the most immune modulating or immune tolerating system. What it does, it decreases the antigen presentation by monocytes and dendritic cells. So if the dendritic cells are not activated, so it will not present antigen. If the antigen is not present on the cell surface, so no question of T cell is getting activated. So what happens, that immune response will be hampered. So in that way, vitamin D plays a pivotal role in immune tolerance. So my next slide is that I have already discussed with the pictorial depiction. So coming to the autoimmune thyroid disease. So I have done some work. So it is basically the autoimmune thyroid disease. You see, that is the Graves disease and Hashimoto thyroiditis. One is hyperthyroidism and one is hypothyroidism. Hashimoto disease is a subclinical hypothyroidism. It is basically both of them T-cell mediated autoimmune disorder causing infiltration of the thyrocytes to the thyroid gland. Worldwide prevalence is 2 to 5%, but let me tell you that is there is a very gender variation of the autoimmune diseases, and we are discussing the autoimmune thyroid disease. Yes, there is a extensive female preponderance that is occurring in the AITD. I have seen in the Hashimoto thyroiditis, the patients we took, more than 500 cases we did, and most of them, 90% were adult females. So there is some reasons because that skewed X chromosome inactivation might be the cause for the so much huge female preponderance of autoimmune diseases, because that is the only causes, and most of it, vitamin D also plays a very important role. So an interplay of genetic predisposition, I will discuss with a case report we got. So with these environmental factors trigger immunity. So now coming to the Hashimoto thyroiditis, it is basically a T cell mediated disease and characterized by, you see, the goiter, presence of circulating anti-TPO antibody, thyroid peroxidase antibody is there, and anti-thyroglobulin antibody is there. Anti-TG and anti-TPO antibody are the most prominent tests we are doing for the diagnosis of the Hashimoto thyroiditis. And we know that here also the intrathyroidal infiltration of B and T cells leads to the varying degrees of thyroid hypofunction. Close association of this HT with the VDD has been documented. So first documentations are there in 2009. So these are the symptoms of hypothyroidism. Nothing new in that. I think most of you know it. So if you don't know, have a look on that. The slide, hair loss, weight gain, increased fatigue, increased blood pressure, painful and prolonged menstruation, chills, convulsions, they are the common symptoms of hypothyroidism. So I have already discussed it. I am not going into details. The same thing, that is the existential factors, that the sex parity. So those who are having children are more likely to have this Hashimoto thyroiditis as compared to the Nali Paris women. And genes are there, you have can have a look on the genes, TGTSHR, thyroid receptor gene, thyroglobulin gene. These are the thyroid specific gene. HLA genes are the CTLA-4, PTPN22, CD40. So these are the genes. And vitamin D, selenium, alcohol, smoking, stress, they are the environmental factors. Role of vitamin D autoimmunity, as I already discussed into my previous slides. So nothing new in that. I will just discuss in the Hashimoto thyroiditis is that vitamin D receptors are found in T and B lymphocytes. It is present in the macrophages. What happens? So if a person is the genetically predisposed, that means, as I told, that if a person is having the locus of DR or DQ locus in the HLA-DR-DQ locus in MHC2 gene, they are much likely to have this disease in audit, when they are exposed to an environmental trigger. Now, one most important thing that most of people, they're not bothered about the genetic predisposition, because you know the genetic study is very difficult. It is expensive as well, and is a mass screening of the genetic predisposition is not possible in a country like India. I don't know the scenario in the outside, but in India, it is very difficult. But what lies the importance of the genetic study? Because you know that HD and GD, and T1DM and other autoimmune diseases, there is a sibling ratio. What does it mean? If a person having this disease, so I can explain with HT, Hashimoto thyroiditis, here the sibling ratio is greater than 10. You can imagine, or for Graves' disease, it is greater than 20. So if a person is having, if a child is having, or if a person is having this HT or GD, so it is 20 times or 10 times more likely their siblings to get afflicted with the diseases. So you can see, so if you can study, and if you can study the whether the person is genetically predisposed, then the family members will be aware of these things, and they can avoid the environmental factors which triggered the autoimmunity. So here also, polymorphisms of vitamin D, I will discuss in my next slide. So what is that? Breakdown of immune tolerance after the interplay of the environmental triggers with a genetic predisposition. So there is a generation of larger number of T helper cells and cytotoxic lymphocytes. Then there is an accumulation of immune cells in the thyroid gland. And what happens? Prevalence of Th1 mediated diseases in the cytotoxic effects in the thyroid, and ultimately causes the apoptosis of the thyrocyte, and so hypothyroidism. So this is the pictorial representations, not going into detail for that. Now coming to my own work, what I did. So we did in 2015, because 2009 only this association of these HT and vitamin D deficiency first published in British Journal of Nutrition. In the consecutive years, cellular and molecular immunology, and there are very other papers, reputed journals, they depicted the association. But you know that these are all observational studies, and no such study was then there in 2015 in Eastern India. So we did that, and it was a pilot study. So sitting at the hospital, it's not possible to go the population study, but we got an indications. So in our study, we published in British Journal of Medicine and Medical Research. So we did the study on here when it was published, it was 150, but later on we increased the numbers. So 78% of the vitamin D deficiency we got, 48.4. Can you imagine? That is the persons who come with the clinical, subclinical hypothyroidism and put on the ultroxinoid, thyronorm, or the thyroid lowering drugs. They are not knowing that they are having the anti-TPO positivity. And there is a significant correlation, negative correlation with the anti-TPO and vitamin D levels. So we just divided our study group in three cases. So I'm showing that this is a pie chart of this. So if you can have a look that we measured the NTTP of vitamin D, PTH, calcium, phosphorus, ALK, thyroglobulin, every parameters, possible parameters which can upsurge the increase of the NTTP of positivity. So we got that. So overt hypothyroidism based on TSH level greater than 10. So we just included some patients into the overt hypothyroidism category based on where the TSH level is greater than 10. When it is 5 to 10, greater than 5 but less than 10, that is subclinical, and when it is normal, that is the controlled population. You see there is a positive correlation of vitamin D with the anti-TPO in this control, but in subclinical hypothyroidism, there is a moderate decrease negative correlation, and in case of the overt hypothyroidism, there is a steep decline of anti-TPO and vitamin D. So now, the other thing, we also extended our study on the gestational hypothyroidism. So the pregnant patients who used to come, or you came in the, for 2 years we did the study, and we did the study for 365 pregnant mothers who came Ramakrishna Mission Seva Pratishthan for a routine checkup. So they have come for the routine checkup. So no question of anti-TPO testing was there. No question of vitamin D testing there. Because let me tell you that vitamin D testing is an expensive testing. Anti-TPO testing also a very, very expensive testing. So in our charitable hospital, it causes 1,000 rupees, more than 1,000 rupees or more than 3,000 rupees otherwise. So doctors cannot recommend that you go for vitamin D testing or you go for anti-TPO testing. The mothers, they come and they get routinely checked and the other things for the pregnancy. But we know that vitamin D deficiency causes gestational hypothyroidism, and most importantly, anti-TPO positivity. It poses a very detrimental effect on labor. It causes IUGR, that is intrauterine growth retardation. It causes preterm labor. It causes spontaneous abortion. It causes preeclampsia. So many things, mental retardation, so many things. So it does. But nobody is aware of that. These ladies, these women, they're completely unaware of their anti-TPO positivity. And the doctors, they were not. So whenever I approached the clinicians, please get them tested for anti-TPO positivity. So they told, how could they afford? But we, our group, need to spread the awareness that it is required. For that, we did on our project money. So what we did, we firstly screened 1,133 pregnant women. After initial screening, what we found that 47% of that GHT, and you know that GHT or gestational hypothyroidism also is a very detrimental or the very bad effect on pregnancy, but nobody knows of that. Though now TSH in the obstetric patients, we get into biochemistry laboratory, but anti-TPO testing still no. 86.4% of the GHT patients having the vitamin D deficiency, but they are not tested. They are tested for our own interest, for research interest, but they were not recommended to go for vitamin D deficiency in the year 2015 to 2017. But I must say that after publishing these studies and after going to the clinicians and spreading awareness and after conversing with the clinicians, now the testing of vitamin D deficiency has increased definitely. 72.3 euthyroid pregnant patients who didn't show the elevated TSH level, they were also vitamin D deficient. 28.7, can you believe that 28.7% autoimmune thyroiditis was observed in the GHT patients? They were completely aware of that. When they came and asked, what is that? So we just asked them, we advised the patients to go and show this report to the clinicians. So they will do the needful things. To our surprise, that is our study also demonstrated 3% autoimmunity in the euthyroid women as well. But it is documented, so because I have seen many papers who documented or demonstrated that 1 to 2% of autoimmunity in the pregnant women. So naturally, so it was our study. So there are many studies that that time we are working on autoimmunity. So we renowned endocrinologist, he collaborated with us and he gave us 51 type 1 diabetes patients. And we tested GAD, glutamate acid decarboxylase enzyme for that. And you know that we got 36% of the T1DM patients who showed the GAD positivity. And you know the persons who are GAD positive, they are most likely to develop Hashimoto thyroiditis or poorly autoimmune syndrome, that is polyglandular endocrinopathies. So you know that. So our study in this type 1 diabetes, on type 1 diabetes patients, it was selected for poster presentations in International Diabetic Federation there. So that time, getting 50 diabetic patients in India, in West Bengal, is a big task. And we did that and we see that is the, yes, vitamin D deficiency was there. And most of the type 1 diabetes patients, I must say that 36%, so not all 36%, but if I can remember correctly, 15 to 20% of the T1DM patients, they showed HT, anti-TPO positivity. So now coming to the interesting case, that is the polyglandular autoimmunity with Hashimoto thyroiditis. So we got a case. A girl of 6 years, she came to our lab and with all symptoms of diabetes. And so her sugar level was very high. If I can recall correctly, her FBS was, it's very high, 373, and her PPBS was 500. And her C-peptide was very low, so it satisfied all the criteria for type 1 diabetes. She was admitted under an endocrinologist at our hospital. After 1 week, she developed some symptoms of the swelling, and we tested anti-TPO, and anti-TPO level was some 1,000. Then we did that. This patient showed the type 1 diabetes. This patient showed the HT, TSH level was high. And then we did the other tests. We did also for vitamin B12, we did cortisol. And we did that the other test to identify or to categorize in which category this girl falls. So it is the, so we ultimately categorized this girl into the polyglandular autoimmune, PAAs 3A, because the girl did not develop in alopecia, or it does not develop in Addison's disease, or it does not pernicious anemia. She didn't display the symptoms, or the, because her vitamin B12 level was within the normal range. So in that cases, we can say we categorize. So, and when we got this, then it intrigues us the whether this girl is genetically predisposed. Let us see. So we got the antigen testing, genetic testing. And this girl shows HLA-DR and DQ locus in her. So, and upon investigation, it revealed that the cow, this girl was on cow milk. So what we can see is that upon consumption of the cow milk, so it's a single case cannot determine the genetic interactions. But the thing is that it is an indication, a case report, but it is an indication that satisfy that gene environment interactions plays an important role in developing autoimmunity. There are so many polymorphisms and VDR polymorphisms are there with AITD. Just excuse me. I need to switch on my phone. Thank you for your patience. So VDR polymorphisms with AITD. So we got that if there is a single nucleotide polymorphisms in the vitamin D receptors, that is the VDR polymorphism. So FOP1 polymorphism is very much associated with the HT, type 1 diabetes. It might be there because we know that MHC gene, it causes the overlapping regions of many autoimmune diseases. That's why it clusters in a family. So if one autoimmunity is there, So there are many papers in type 1 diabetes paper in South India. And outside India, there are also papers. They demonstrated the association. So this might be the cause because the genetic overlapping regions of many autoimmune diseases. So that leads to the production of this autoimmunity. So FOC1 is that it's the exon 2. There is a polymorphism, consecutive two codons, there is a mutations, and there is a T2G, if I can remember. So that is important for causing autoimmune disease. So vitamin D polymorphism, nobody studies. So my question is that if we are having milk, being an affluent family, if we are having fish, if we are having many things, the sources of vitamin D, it is true that we are not exposed to sunlight, adequate sunlight so much, but we did many things for getting our vitamin D adequate. So vitamin D polymorphisms might be considered for causing vitamin D deficiency in today's arena. Now coming to the most pertinent point, that is the effect of vitamin D supplementations. It is a very, very recent study. It is 2018 study, I suppose. They did a randomized double-blind placebo control trial. There, the effects of vitamin D supplementation on the thyroid function in hypothyroid patients. And they showed that after vitamin D supplementation, so definitely thyroid function getting improved, anti-TPO level getting down, TSH getting down. I can share a personal experience of mine. So my daughter, she also developed anti-TPO positivity when she was very stressed in her 12th exam. But after admitting in the engineering college and after coming to this, so then she was supplemented vitamin D. And without, believe me, without putting on Thyronorm or other disease, other thyroid lowering diseases, she's now perfectly okay. So one case might not be conclusive. So I have not done vitamin D supplementation on the hypothyroid patients because doctors are not agreed, because there is also a controversy whether the supplementation improves the thyroid functions, but I'm really interested to do that. So it opens a new avenue to treat non-skeletal diseases and archetypes of disease in childhood. These paper demonstrated a meta-analysis of these observational studies, and they showed that type 1 diabetes is significantly reduced in those who are supplemented with vitamin D. And they also told that incidence rate of type 2 diabetes is 50% lower if they are given or they are supplemented with the 25-hydroxy vitamin D. So it has been demonstrated in many studies that it reduces the incidence of diabetes, PCOS, CKD, COPD, and cancer with vitamin D supplementations. So there are in 2016, that is the Food Safety and Standard Authority of India, they did a study and they said that standards for fortification of food items like salt, edible oil, milk, wheat, and rice with iron, folic acid, vitamin D, and vitamin A might still doubt whether the patients are getting fortified vitamin D products. So from around 60% vitamin D deficiency in the beginning of the century, it has now come down. It is an old slide, 2013. I think that it is now getting importance among the clinicians so that vitamin D testing has been increased. In my day-to-day lab practice, I have seen, and definitely they're working on that. So conclusion is that vitamin D deficiency should not be ignored. It should be considered as a public health problem, though it is underrated, but we should not ignore it. So it should be recognized by the government body so that the healthcare funds can be allocated appropriately. And implementation of population-based educational and interventional strategies to combat this serious problem. Otherwise, what we have done, we have this the hospital-based study. So large participants, population-based study is very, very essential to reach a conclusion. So I'm deeply acknowledge the Ramakrishna Mission, Shiva Pratishthan, and the secretary and my students and my laboratory technicians. They are really, really very supportive. Whenever I require any help, my technicians, they extended their help to any extent. They never said, madam, we cannot do it. Whenever they're not paid for that, but they helped me to draw blood, to do tests, everything. So I really acknowledge my laboratory medical technologists. And definitely I acknowledge Professor Geeta Talukdar, because she instilled research instinct in me. Though I'm working in a biochemist, I'm not in a proper research lab. So, but I am very much eager to do research, so to do more things for the betterment of the mankind. So I thank you, everybody, for your patient hearing. And I also thank Michael Hollick for pioneering the vitamin D research. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Rinini, for your nice presentation. And I would like to ask everybody to raise their questions, if any. I also put the query in the YouTube. So still YouTube, there is no question. And if any Zoom, you want any, you have any question, please. Anybody can unmute themselves and question. Otherwise, we hand over the microphone to Prof. Gushwarani.
Okay. So thank you, Dr. Sandeep, and also Dr. Rinini for the really good presentation. So even though this my field is different from you because I'm from forestry, but it's really good to know about, I think, this vitamin D. This really important for us. I'm surprised this your result about, if I'm not mistaken, about 87.2% for vitamin D deficiency in
more
in
than the, that I think
yes so
yes,
I think
more than that.
Maybe also in happen in Indonesia as well, because about this, you know, this problem in the world. Like you mentioned before. Sorry if I give a question first. I think this everyone from medical school here, from the Faculty of Medicine, and also from, I think, biology, chemistry, I think this, I think this your turn to ask Dr. Rinini. But it's okay because Dr. Sandeep already gave me a chance for the first time. Thank you. This is my question. Just I'm wondering to, because you mentioned about for the vitamin D, this for the cause of deficiency because of the hereditary. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So from the parents, they inherit to their kids or the children for the vitamin D deficiency. So
Pardon, madam, it is autoimmune diseases. So autoimmune diseases that.
Okay. So yes, not yes. Just for the vitamin D. So that's why I'm just curious about that. Yes. Also, I think for the autoimmune also, this is most common problem also in Indonesia as well. I have some friends, they have problem also for the their health about the autoimmune. Yeah, I think the term of autoimmune is like, you know, we just know this recently. In few years ago, especially for me, I didn't know about this autoimmune. But I know some friends, they have a problem about that. So this I'm curious about how, this specific cause to to make this autoimmune for the people. Because for example, I have a friend, a woman, and she just got autoimmune after she delivered her kids for the second one. And for the first kid, it's okay for her. Yeah. Mm. She was very healthy. But after delivering her baby, and she got autoimmune. And until now. So maybe a little bit you can also like the share us the how the I mean what's the problem to create also
it's to not make- like that. It might be that that time she was diagnosed, it was suppressed, that she might be genetically predisposed, or it might be that in that time environmental factors, she being exposed, that triggers autoimmunity in that point of time. You never know when the environmental triggers to develop autoimmunity, so you never know. So this time I'm okay, but I know that in coming years whether I will develop autoimmunity. So that's why it's very important, the environmental factors which causes autoimmunity. So we need to check on the environmental factors, and similarly, we need to go for the genetic testing. Though it is not very feasible, but if we can opt that, then we can have a restrict on that, that we should not have these. See, I'm telling you that if, as I discussed the child. So in my case report, if it is well known that he is genetically predisposed, and if it is well known that for type 1 diabetes, cow milk is an environmental factor. So in that case, if she knows that she is genetically predisposed, so she should avoid the environmental factor that triggers the autoimmune response. So in that way, we can restrict our exposure to the environmental causal agents that causes autoimmunity. So that's the thing. Whenever it occurs, nobody knows.
Okay, thank you. So maybe for the second question, Dr. Sandeep, I'm just curious about between environmental factor and also for genetic factors, is which one is the most serious problem to make for the autoimmune? Because right now we live in a lot of pollution. And I don't know, like from the scientific journal or from based on your result, which one, genetic factors or environmental factors?
Madam, it is a genetic and environmental interplay. It is an interplay. Not only that, everybody that I am having cow milk or I am having something which causes autoimmunity, but I'm not genetically predisposed. Mm-hmm. So might not that environmental factor will lead to cause autoimmunity in me. But if I am genetically predisposed, might be that environmental factor causes or augments or enhances to develop autoimmunity in me. So that might be a balance of that. When your T cell will upset, so the vitamin D, I think it is why I'm emphasizing that, because nobody knew about that. Everybody knows that vitamin D is important for skeletal development, for bone mineral homeostasis. Nobody knows that it is so important in non-skeletal diseases. So if having supplemented with the vitamin D or these things which can increase our serum concentrations of vitamin D, so in that case, we might delay the onset of the metabolic diseases. We might delay the causal agents for the autoimmunity. So in that way, we can do it.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for this. It's really good.
Thank you. Actually, madam, it is true. And vitamin D have many effects, actually. Mm-hmm. And as many of us not exposed to sunlight,
yes,
we cover our body with every time we are in office inside the dark room. Yeah. So that sunlight not producing, means touching our skin. And so we all of us getting vitamin D deficient.
Yes.
And now the milk also there. And milk is, we are going for fat-free milk. Actually, fat-free milk is without any chemical. That is not milk.
Yeah.
We don't know, but we are health conscious. We go to shop, we search for fat-free milk.
Yes.
So that is not giving the source of calcium and vitamin D at all. So these are many factors are there, and these environmental factor, who is exposed and whom it will trigger, that is controlled by our gene.
Okay.
So somebody is getting exposed, and as Dr. Dini told. Yeah. So, madam, thank you, madam, for raising good questions.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, okay.
And another question is there from Dr. Seema Singh. Yes, Seema, you want to speak or I read the question? You can unmute yourself and ask.
Hello.
Yes, Seema.
Hello. Good evening to everyone, sir.
Yes.
Sir, my question is for vitamin D deficiency, only the sunlight and vitamin D medicines are the solutions or anything other? Because one of the member in my family is suffering from the kidney related problem, and also he is deficient in vitamin D. For that kind of person, what we should take precaution or anything which is very good for, which is good for recovering in case of vitamin D actually?
Yes, Rini, you want
Yes. I want to answer. See, in case of the CKD or nephrotic syndromes, as you mentioned, that we get patients for that who are vitamin D deficient. So exposure to sunlight for getting covered by vitamin D deficiency is not feasible. So what doctors, they recommend the vitamin D supplements. So I think vitamin D supplements are the way to replenish your vitamin D deficiency. And not only that after there is a dose, you can cover to recover vitamin D deficiency, and there will be a maintenance dose you need to follow to be vitamin D sufficient or to maintain your vitamin D level. So supplementation is the way doctors usually supplement the vitamin D. So for myself, I can say that I was severely vitamin D deficient. It was less than 8. So our auto-analyzer CLIA platform, they cannot measure vitamin D below than that. I was that much sufficient, but I was totally asymptomatic. So I was put on supplementations. I took the supplementations and I'm okay. So I think supplementation is the answer. And that way you can get rid of vitamin D deficiency. Or the fortified food, that can also help. But exposure to sunlight, I think it's not practically feasible, or that can improve your vitamin D level to that extent.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Shima. I would like to introduce Dr. Shima. Is one of our ex-students, and she already awarded PhD, and she is now government college lecturer in India. Thank you, Shima, for joining. And another thing I must tell, that as he is suffering for kidney disease, maybe it is for he has uric acid or gout problem. So we must check that one. Because if we take more animal food, animal source protein for vitamin D replacement, so maybe it will increase the gout chance, and that will increase the kidney stone and etc. formation. So if uric acid is there, very dangerous. So we must control that. Otherwise, kidney dialysis and kidney failure may happen. So that is very important aspect of the gout, uric acid. And as Dr. Rini told, supplement of vitamin D, as all of us know that vitamin D is the family member of ADEK, fat soluble vitamin. If it is hypervitaminosis, then it will not go out from our body easily. So we must take a controlled dose, and we must take proper monitoring, not take simply vitamin D, somebody taking, so I also take, not like that. So we should consult with doctor and test, and accordingly we should take. Vitamin D we should not take abruptly, as not only vitamin D, all multivitamin, ADEK. Vitamin B complex, no problem. We can take, it will water soluble, it will go out with our urine. But if vitamin D or fat soluble vitamin, that is difficult. So we must suggest also that, as we told, that cod liver oil and that type of sea fish is the sources of vitamin D and milk. So we can go for that. So that is another option. So any other questions from any? Thank you. Any other questions? Any student? I think no question more. So,
maybe madam, we can find also from Indonesia, maybe some.
Yes, Miss Ulifiti is there, one of our students.
I have a question.
Yes. Hello? Rini? Hello, Dr. D.
Problem with the connection, maybe.
Yes, if I can give some, means if it is vitamin D excess, it will have some problem. And hypervitaminosis of vitamin D, everybody can see in the book. And if it is, means increased amount, as I told, it is not water soluble, so it will not go out with urine so quickly. It will stay in our body, so it will cause some problem if it is hypervitaminosis dose. So we cannot take suppose we the dose is one tablet for means one capsule per day, we cannot take 10 capsule like that. But in case of vitamin C, in case of COVID, we are telling that you take vitamin C more. It will boost your, so vitamin C, if we can take 4 tablet, means 4 into 500 milligram, it is around 2 gram per day. That also will not affect bad effect. But if we take vitamin D in that respect, to a 2 tablet or 4 tablet, we will feel problem. Okay, so this is one answer. And about the COVID relationship, I am not aware about that because I have not so much experience in vitamin D. So I am also aware.
Yeah, because there are some treatment if we exposure with the sunlight in the mornings, it also increase the our antibody as well.
Yes.
That we see is also important for COVID-19 treatment as well. So maybe it's also have the theory about the vitamin D in here.
Just a yeah. আবার কানেক্ট করো জুমে she is joining already lost connectivity
I see
actually there was a cyclone before 1 month as madam knows in Kolkata and after that still the line is not recovered everywhere internet
okay
like professor Mohsar they also cannot join today very poor she cannot talk in WhatsApp also and also now a few days very raining now again
okay.
So that is the problem now so she is joining
okay
and actually other cause of vitamin D we know that in Malaysia and other place here actually many persons suffering with diabetes and that diabetes actually causing the osteoporosis
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And this is not only diabetes causing osteoporosis, vitamin D deficiency also there because we cover our body. That is one of the reasons. So sunlight cannot touch our body. We stay in our AC room. We don't go to sunlight. If we do walk, we do evening walk. We don't do morning walk because morning walk, sunlight can come. But we don't do morning walk because for the heat, means total... Heat sun here in Malaysia. We if we go to sun, we will get sunburned. If we stay,
I'm sorry, my net got disconnected.
Yes, the question is for you, Dr. Rini, that Dr. Agustin asking that is there any relationship of vitamin D and COVID? We can think.
Yes, you can. You can. I can say though.
Yes,
though
please.
We have not studied, but since vitamin D elicits immune response and it has a very protective role of immunity, so we know that in the immune suppression occurs in COVID. So there is a so definitely there might be a relationship of the vitamin D with the COVID. I suppose though I have not studied or I have not got any studies, but there should be a relationship. See, vitamin D causes the immunomodulation, so there might be a role. That might be a relationship of vitamin D with the COVID.
And another question he asked that what is the hypervitaminosis activity of vitamin D? If we take
hypervitaminosis, yes, if it is greater than 100, so it is the potential toxicity. So it's getting deposited into liver, kidney, and other organs. So there are some hypervitaminosis activity. The fatigue, cramp, muscle cramp occurs, fatigue occurs. So there are some symptoms that leads to hypervitaminosis D. So it is very dangerous. So if we get greater than 100, so we usually report to clinicians to get the necessary measurements for that. So there are some symptoms of vitamin D.
So how can we analyze ourselves to know is the enough or not in our body?
Yes.
Is it some instrument for analyze that?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Let me tell you, that is vitamin D, there is a test. It is a diagnostic test. There we are measuring in an autoanalyzer. That is the methodology used for vitamin D. It is the chemiluminescence. So enhanced chemiluminescence method we use. And there are some autoanalyzers in biochemistry where we measure or we test vitamin D. And there is the reference range of that. If your serum concentrations of vitamin D, usually we measure 25 hydroxy vitamin D total. That means that the endogenously synthesized onto your body and what you are taking from dietary sources. So the total 25-OH vitamin D we are measuring, and if your serum concentrations is less than the deficient range, that is less than 20, then you are deficient. If it is 20 to 29, then it is insufficient. If it is 30 to 100, then you are sufficient. And if it is greater than 100, then you are toxic. So in that way, you can get yourself tested for vitamin D.
Thank you, Dr. Rini.
Thank you.
Actually, I worked in lab also, diagnostic lab, but I worked in molecular biology aspect of diagnosis of HIV, etc. in diagnostics lab. But I see the Camille Lemonnier's machine. I know that the range, etc. She is the best person because she handling that part in the lab.
She is managing the whole lab,
biochemistry lab in the hospital. So thank you, Rini, for your answer. And
you.
Also, I would like to say that I worked on iron. Same thing. If we give ferrous sulfate as iron sulfate supplement for the pregnant women. But if the ferrous sulfate, if it is more, it is poison.
Mm-hmm.
It is great poison. And it is named as Hirakosh in Bengali. So it is a very toxic thing.
Iron toxicity is also.
So, and that will lead to hepatomegaly and other diseases. So we will discuss that one at another meeting, madam.
Okay.
And thank you for everybody joining.
Thank you, madam.
And
so another question, Dr. Sandeep, please.
Yes, we give that token of appreciation certificate.
So I just read from on YouTube.
Yes, I show the certificate, you can see.
Yeah.
Thank you. This certificate offered to Dr. Rini Jasana.
Thank you so much,
for
Dr. Poddar and madam.
Appreciation from all of us. From my father, Dr. Surjubodha Poddar, president of Dr. Tarakanath Poddar Memorial Foundation. My brother is around in this chat. He is also professor of Ayurvedic Medical Science. And Dr. Alan Puri, the rector, Patpetula University. I think sir is not around. Madam Gushwaran is around. He is the vice rector of Patpetula University also.
Mm-hmm.
And she has another post in Bengaluru University.
Yeah.
And Dr. Awal, Dean of Faculty of Medicine Health Science, and Professor Dr. Irfan Gustin, he also around in the chat box, I see, in the participant. So from all of us, we thank Dr. Rini and also for participating. And all participants will get the certificate because they have filled the particular response form, and it will take maybe 7 days time. So you will get by auto, because part day it will go around 100, etc. So, and also I am thankful to all senior members. I have seen Dr. Mala Bose and Dr. Ajanta Haldar. Many senior persons are present in this meeting room. Thank you all for joining. And also, madam, thank you for joining the medical faculty.
Excuse me, Dr. Sandeep.
Yes, yes.
Do we have time for, I get the question from here from YouTube.
Oh, okay. Yes, please. Yes.
Yeah. So sorry about that, Dr. Rinini.
No. Yes.
This is from Dr. Asmi, medical doctor. Right now he is as vice rector for student affairs at Faculty of Medicine and Health Science at University of Bengkulu. His question first, he has two questions. Question number one, what is the signaling mechanism that is affected by vitamin D in this autoimmune disease? FOC1 or something else? I can continue for the question number two. Will vitamin D fortification in children reduce the risk of autoimmune disease in the future?
Okay.
Is it okay?
So, I can hear, madam. So the easy one, I can say the fortification of food for the children to get rid of vitamin D deficiency, the research is also going on. So there are many controversial output. That is, some group of researchers, they found that supplementing vitamin D or fortified food that improves the vitamin D level a group of researchers says, as I told you, that in archives of child disease, so these paper, they demonstrated, there are other papers also, they demonstrated that upon fortification of food, if we can take, if the children are put on the fortified vitamin D food, their vitamin D levels increases. But a group of researchers, they said that it's not. So it depends on the your locality or your country. And the observational study I recommend, that whether it will help. So you can go for fortification and you get the tested, get it tested, the children, that whether these level before fortification and after fortification, so whether it is getting improved. If it is improved, so you can make a pilot study on that, and then you can extend the larger participants and you can have a conclusion. So that is, I recommend, that is, you have to go for your own study. But there are many studies, both of them, that a group of researchers is, that is, the conflicting answers are there, fortification of food. And your first question is that how we, I have already explained in my slides that there is an intricate mechanism how vitamin D immunomodulate, the immunomodulatory role of the vitamin D is very much appreciated nowadays. That is how it is, it decreases the pro-inflammatory cytokines. So it protects your self antigen by the B cell or T cells, B cell humoral response, B cells elicits humoral response. So vitamin D causes the apoptosis of the B cells. So the vitamin B cells cannot further go for clonal selection. So it cannot multiply. If it is cannot multiply, then what will happen? It will not secrete the autoantibody against the self antigen. And similarly, it decreases the cytotoxic T cells activity. So most of the cases, what happens, that we know that T cells are two types. That is, the helper cells are two types, that is CD4 and CD8. So what it happens, that it decreases the antigen presenting cells activity. If the cells, the dendritic cells, phagocytes, monocytes, if they're at the cells, they present the antigen on the cell surface and it invites the T cell to attack that. There is a mechanism that vitamin D, it decreases the concentrations of the antigen presentation. And if the antigen is not presented, then T cells will be of no use. So it will not elicit immune response. So in that way, vitamin D helps in the immune modulation, or you can say that immune tolerance mechanism.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Rinini. And also thank you, Dr. Ahmad Asmi, for this your question. Dr. Sandeep, we have also another question on the room chat.
Yes.
From Dr. Seema Singh, I think.
There is one, I think, in Malay, in YouTube. Jam Barapu Vakta Tepa Tantu Mendakan Sinar Matahari Kirim Sinar Matahari Juga Minyang UV Yang Juga Bar Baha Antuk Kulit. Madam, I copy this.
Okay. So I didn't see here. I just
from Irma.
Irma.
No, Irma Badriana.
Irma Badarina. Okay, that this is from University of Bengkulu.
Yes.
Okay.
This is the question I write here in the chat box.
Okay. Let me see first. Maybe you can also answer first. Just another question from Dr. Seema Singh before.
No, already done. I think Seema Singh asked.
This is about the deficiency vitamin D medicine.
Yes, yes. Only done, madam.
Okay. Let me see for the YouTube first. Okay.
I give in the Zoom chat box, madam. That Malay one.
Irma. Okay. Okay. This. Yeah. Her question from Irma Badarina. What time for the good time to get this for the sunlight? Yeah.
Sunlight.
Because the sunlight is also this related to the UV. And also for dangers for this our skin. So that's why she asked about what specific time is a good time to for us to get a touching for the sunlight. Yeah, thank you.
The answer I can say, that is, the exposure of the UVB light is essential for synthesis of the vitamin D on your skin. So 7-dehydrocholesterol, that is getting vitamin D in presence of UVB light. Now, it depends the zenith angle of the sun. So zenith angle is an angle, how it radiates. So if the zenith angle of West Bengal is different, might be different from Malaysia or from other parts of the India. Mm-hmm. So depending on the zenith angle of this sun, the exposure we get, that depends. So it might be somewhere else that 8 to 10 is a good time. Somewhere it might be in the peak noon, in the 12. Mm-hmm. So it depends on the zenith angle, the more or less when the you get the adequate sun exposure. So I think that is, it is 10 to 12. It is the mid noon. So then you can expose. But it is a very difficult. Some doctors say, or some researchers say, you should expose yourself into the morning sun. Okay. So it depends on the angle. The important thing, the concept of that, you need to get the UVB rays. So that is essential for synthesis of your vitamin D. So depending on that, you can say. And the morning sunlight is not when the sun gets up, not very much that is you don't need to be scorching sunlight, but you get adequate exposure of the sunlight. That will be sufficient to synthesize your vitamin D on skin.
Yes, you are right. Actually, in 10 a.m. in morning, if we go out in Malaysia, it is very hot.
Yeah.
Yes.
And if it is morning 7 a.m., it is dark. No sun yet. So in Indonesia, maybe 6 a.m., it is dark. And 9 a.m. is very hot.
Yeah.
We cannot go out. So within 7 to 8 hours.
I'd like to share that in the rural case also, where the farmers and all, they are working in the field. So they're getting exposed into the mid sunlight. So they should not get the vitamin D deficient. But it happens. So I think that there might be vitamin D receptor polymorphism that might need to be investigated, whether there are hidden causes of vitamin D. As he also pointed out that we are very health conscious. We are applying sunscreen while going out in the sun so that to get rid of, we shouldn't get black, darkened. So
no,
that
there is another thing also there. In here, they don't go out in field farmers. They cover their body when they go for work.
Yeah, that is also a cause. That might be a cause.
Okay, thank you, Dr.
Okay. Other question, Ms. Yoga also answered already. Same question. So, thank you. Thank you, madam, for checking. My YouTube was hanged, so I cannot get the question.
No problems. Yeah, okay, my pleasure. Okay.
Thank you all for joining.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much.
And next week,
nice,
madam, we are going to do the 1 week program from next week. I am making the schedule. I'll give to everybody so that everybody can join.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Purda, Shundipa. Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining.
Okay, madam.
Thank you, madam.
Very much for your interest.
Thank you all for joining.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Irfan, the Dean of the Faculty of Medical Science.
We cannot see you, sir.
Yes. Maybe Professor Irfan, you want to say something?
Yes, please.
Yes, okay. Maybe Dr. Sandeep, we can invite Dr. Professor Irfan.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, Dr. Sandeep.
Yes,
thank you for your invited our faculty to join this forum. I think the next time we will be joining like this program. In our faculty, we have nursing program study and white fairy program study. I think it's good for me. Thank you.
Yes. Actually, in Lincoln, we have nursing diploma to PhD, diploma, bachelor, master's, and PhD in nursing.
Okay.
BKL also have, dental also have,
yeah.
Also pharmacy diploma, my master's, bachelor, master's, PhD,
full
level, and also management. So agriculture also now starting bachelor of agriculture. So biotechnology also there, master's and bachelor level. And PhD Applied Science is there, PhD Nursing, PhD Health Science, PhD Medical Physiology, many programs are there. So we are also doing many conferences and also journal publications, etc. We'll definitely collaborate and invite all of you to what you call encourage the students to take part of all these events so that everybody can aware and get some information.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Irfan. Thank you.
We are very sorry, Dr. Sandeep and also Dr. Rini, because Dr. Ahmad Azmi, he couldn't join us because the problem for the connection, but he's watching and join us on YouTube. Yeah, okay. So maybe, he cannot.
Thank you, sir, for joining.
Yeah, his speech here, okay. Thank you. Also, Professor Alnopri also sends the warmest regards to everyone here, because he right now he's traveling from Curup to Bengkulu. He just sent message to me. He's very sorry cannot join us, but just enjoy for the lecture. Okay, thank you
again. And I must tell again, I remember Dr. Digita Talukdar as in memory of that, and she always encouraged all women scientists.
Yes.
As you know that she was the scientific advisory committee member of Government of India, central government, and she is the in charge of Eastern region of women development. All women she encouraged. Like Rinini, many women researchers are there working under her and get graduation.
She encouraged a lot.
She encouraged, and as you see that Dr. Madhusudan Dey, she left the government job for working as a scientist, research position under her. So that is the thing. And she is also very helpful. She suffered from cancer in the final stage. From cancer bed, she knows that what her scholar can do.
Yes.
She told me that you join there, but you will leave after 1 month, I know. Because what I will do after 1 month of one service, she know already that this person will not work there for more than 1 hour or month. But she recommended me for go there,
So Chundinda, I would like to share that time she was very ill. Didi was very ill, and then there was an international symposium on thalassemia and hemoglobinopathy.
Yes, we and both are there. The director general was there, Government of India. Why you not ask for job?
Yes.
But she knows that we will not ask. So that type of inner thoughts she has inside. So thank you for joining
us. Thank you. It's a privilege for me.
Thank you,
madam.
Thank you. So we end the meeting, madam, with your permission, sir. Dr. Irfan.
Yeah.
We end the meeting. Thank you.
Leaving meeting.
Okay. Thank you so much. See you. Bye bye. Okay.
Bye.
Stay safe. Stay well. So everybody is home, and I think Mr. Vishnu is outside. I can see.
On the top, sir.
Okay. So everybody is enjoying their life and in home itself, mainly confinement, actually, type of prison. So I am just here to discuss today on depression and research. I think today is Mother's Day, so everybody... we are praying for our mothers and also get rid of depression with the praying. So now, today I'm talking on depression and research. So what is depression? As you know, depression is the hot air from the ground by the sunrise. The hot air goes up and there is a vacuum. And that vacuum, the cold air comes, and there is a cold and hot, what you call, the front is in connection, then there is a rain. So after the rain, the depression is over. So like that, in our daily life, the depression comes, and there is some cloudy environment, the storm, and after that, the rain, and the depression over afterwards. So here also, like in previously in... Europe, there is a industry revolution. That time depression come, it was over. After that, many depression come, like last 2-3 years back, there is a Brexit in Europe. The economic recession was there. Many person, Greece, UK, many person jobless. Now, maybe they have come up or not, I don't know yet. US also having depression, the recession that time. So all this recession leads to depression. We don't know when we are depressed, but everybody of us become depressed. We don't know that I am depressed or you are depressed. We are doing natural, means leading a natural life, but inside we are already depressed. So this is called, in psychologically, it is called black dog. Depression is a black dog. And under the black dog, so it is under depression. So as a recession, I told, means suppose economic recession is there. Many person getting jobless now. Suppose many bus, train, airport is closed. So many person get jobless. Hotel, restaurant, tourism industry fully stopped. So everybody don't get to have any money in their hand. They cannot run their business. Person dying, the laborers, they're working in different places. You know, you have heard that in India, many places, they are walking with their family to home country because they cannot eat. They don't have any food. So one bread they are sharing between the family member within 2 days. No other food is there. So many NGO is coming up to support many person. Ministers also giving, the chief ministers also giving the fund to many NGO. Many NGO take the money for themselves. They don't give charity, but some of them, of course, giving. Not that everybody is taking the money in their pocket. But the thing is that not that 100% support is get there. So many person getting economically depressed. And this recession will continue for long days because the vaccine is not so easily can be developed in COVID. So if we discuss on this thing, we become more depressed. What is depression? Just to tell in a nutshell, depression is a mood of disorder that causes a persistent feeling of sadness. I am become sad because this thing going on in all over the world. Your friend, my friend, not getting job, means losing job also, not whoever getting job. And then some person dying. So these are become feeling of sadness and loss of interest. I am losing interest in my work. Finally, there's a variety of emotional and physical problems coming up, and symptoms of depression are feeling of sadness, emptiness, angry outburst, I am become angry suddenly, then sleep disturbance, I cannot sleep at night, changes in appetite, I am become hungry sometimes, I don't become feeling at all food, means need food at all, I'm not taking food, but I am gaining weight, like that. So this is called anxiety and troublemaking. These are all physical conditions coming up due to the mental, this means mental, what you call it? Mental depression. Okay. Now, there is a good book, Man's Search for Meaning by Dr. Viktor Frankl. He was a very renowned psychologist and very well-known professor. And he wrote this book, An Introduction to Logotherapy, he is told. And he written this book in prison. In the World War time, he was inside the prison. And then he write this book in diary in his prison time. So in that prison, when the World War there, everybody of the family members, everybody was put inside the prison. Nobody can go out, lockdown. Means lockdown, not lock up. You can tell. So nobody can go out and nobody can take any medicine, anything. So whoever dying, suppose my family member dying in front of me, I cannot do anything. And after that, the dead body also not removed. And that was done by us itself. We have to remove the body and we have to throw out from the home room, like that condition. They were in the prison. So that time he write this book, Man's Search for Meaning. You can get this book in internet also if you search. So what is the meaning of logos? Is in Greek is reason. So he told that there is a some reason to live. That is a motivational thing. As we know, Maslow in business management, of all of us, many management students, we know Maslow. There is a need for motivation, motivational theory. So there, if there is no motivation afterwards, we cannot move up to the we don't have motivation means we are dead. Okay. The Maslow's theory is everywhere we are following. So in this also, if there is no motivation or there is no intention for living, the people will die. Suppose in Victor, when Dr. Victor was in prison, one of the friend was coming rushed to him and told that all his family member died already. But he told, yes, he got a dream last night that on 31st March, he will be relieved from this prison. He will be go out. So Victor did not tell anything. And the 31st March is coming soon, like 10th March, then 20th March, 25th March, 26th March. Then the person see there is no sign for going out for him and there is no clause for going out from the prison. So he become depressed. He stopped taking food. Everything, he loses his intention to live. And 29th, he lie down. 30th, he stopped everything. And 31st, he expired. So this, why he expired? Because he think that he has a target that 31st March, I'll go out. And that target is not achieved. So he go out. In sales, one marketing manager, I have a target I have to reach. Oh, this type of sale I have to make. I cannot reach the target, go out. So depression comes there. So he become addicted with drugs. He have become addicted with alcohol, everything. The same thing. This is a motivational theory. And this motivation works very eminent, means very good, very important role in depression. So if I think that nature conducted this survey in 2 years back, according to their data, they have surveyed 5,700 people of postgraduate study students. So they told that there is need of a quiet room in the university. And where that room will provide, there is a crying time of them. They will cry. Researcher will come in the room and cry. There is a quiet room, like meditation room. You can go to Pondicherry, you have find Aurobindo Ashram, there is a meditation room, quiet zone. Every mission, if you go, there is a quiet zone where you can do meditation. Why? In church you go, there is a father's room, you can go and confess yourself. So these are the meditation chamber or quiet room. So there is a need of quiet room in university, they told. And in Malaysia, we have. Malaysia, we have in colleges, every college, there is a compulsory psychology, means screening center, student counseling center, we told. And that some counseling center is supervised by the psychologist, trained and registered psychologist. So any student getting low score or any student getting any problem in their friendship, in their hostel and etc., they cannot continue study due to financial cause, etc., they can meet with the psychologist in the counseling center. So these are the things, data, that the need of trying time and the quiet room in the university level. But in 2019, when they conduct the survey again, with the 6,300 people, they find that the increase of anxiety level is 36%. In 2 years back, it's 29, now it's 36%. And they sought help for the anxiety and depression related to the PhD work. Okay, so the increasing trend of anxiety and depression is there in our higher study and research. So what are the variables that is leading to this depression? Age, sex, and marital status, and also the economy, maximum cases. So what is this? Age, and you know that all of us is not doing the master degree and immediately to go for PhD. Everybody should have, what you call, a total balance between the salary, etc. After getting job only, they go for higher study. They cannot go. Everybody's family cannot support for PhD, etc. without any income, etc. So there is a scholarship need. There is a need for financial support. There is a job need, etc. So there is, and these are the conditions that affect the PhD study. So during PhD or before PhD, somebody get married also, they get job also, and they doing PhD. And there is a sexual variation also there. We have seen that ladies have to, today is Mother's Day, and that mothers and ladies have to take more responsibility than the males in the house sector. So they are more stressed and may get more depressed during these conditions. Suppose when we do PhD, one of my senior colleague was working in, male ladies of course, she was working in a school, private school. So my guide told, if you want to complete the PhD, you take 2 months leave from the job and come and complete your thesis work. So without that, she cannot concentrate. She was totally engaged in the private school. She cannot come out. So she take 3 months leave the job, come and complete the PhD, and do, after that she go out. So these are the important things that, and again, suppose another lady, every day going for PhD, she was pregnant from Baligan Science College to, suppose, to Shialda. She has to come by tram or taxi. If the tram is not available, have to avail taxi because she is pregnant and cannot travel alone. So she tell, come with me. I have to accompany her, and every day when she come home, I have to accompany, and because she is pregnant. So these are the stress I have to take during the PhD studies. Clear? Then these are the main things affecting the ladies and also the marital status. If I am married, I have the family responsibility, etc. So this conflict of balancing of family and how other PhD work always there in our life. So many persons of us have to cope, cannot cope these two. Okay. So there is a time, we have to give considerable time, we have to afford energy, and also we should have a financial resource. Okay. Now there is a role of mentorship, the guide, supervisor, of course, have a good role. And if he or she support, maximum cases they are supportive, and they give advice how to overcome, because they also passed out their conditions, these conditions. Like I just now told, my guide, she told that you leave the job, otherwise you cannot complete PhD. Anyone you have to choose. So accordingly, she has to leave the job and complete the PhD. Okay. And also, guide sometimes tell, you cannot travel so much. You have to lose the job. Means you have to quit the job. Government service quit by one of my senior colleagues. And she quit the government service doing family with family and doing the research, and after that, visiting professor like that. But she was in government service. She cannot travel, so she leave. As per the guide advice. And it leads to her family life good. Her son is now, one son in UK, one son in US. But I don't know now what is the condition in US, UK. They are very bad condition now. Means country condition is bad, but not that family condition is bad. Family wise, she is happy. Now, if we are depressed during our PhD study due to anxiety and other things, maybe somebody tell we are getting embarrassed with many things. So we don't have to take in our we have to think about this. Okay, whatever we have done is good. Like that type of attitude we have to take. Now we have to take supportive relationship. Like if I tell my junior, means our colleague, okay, I will support you. You support me or like that. So anything he require or she require, I have to support. Every time we have to be supportive in our research field. So that she or he get mentally support, and I also be satisfied that I have supported him. Now, next is, we are doing some experiment in lab. So there is a chance that it will get result or not. Suppose I am doing a vaccine for coronavirus. So failed. We do 1,000 times cancer research. We are doing so many research we are doing. Everybody getting result? The answer is no. There is no result at all. But there is some sort of means advancement. But so there is not that every successful experiment have a result. So we don't think that, oh, I cannot get a vaccine for coronavirus, so my research life is finished. No, not like that. We should not be get depressed. We should try again and again. Now, next is, suppose we are doing the work. So many persons in the lab or outside other labs, they may tell our research colleagues, tell, oh, this is not a good job. This is a very minor job. This is not a minor topic. This is not a very valuable topic like that. But we don't have to think that. We have to focus on our study. Whatever we are thinking is good and betterment for the society, we will focus on that only. We don't have to think that, oh, whatever he told, okay, his perspective, not my perspective. Okay, if we think, oh, he is telling, oh, my work, everything is gone, everything is unfruitful, so I am getting depressed. Clear? Suppose I am sending a manuscript to a journal. Journal reject. I send another journal, reject. I send another journal, reject. So I getting depressed. My article is not published. Otherwise, you see other person, my colleague, he has published 10 articles within that time. I cannot publish a single article. All is rejected. But from there, we have to take a positive approach. Yes, why it is rejected? This is the cause. So I can work on that cause. I can overcome the obstacles and I can publish. So this will be our motivation, that how we can cope up with our depression. Okay? Clear, everybody?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So in research and higher study, we should take care of yourself, ourselves. Life in academia is not so easy. It is a long time of devotion. We have to devote and we have to cope with the family. We have to cope all the necessities of life, etc. So it is not that degree as PhD means doctor of business management like that. It is a doctor of philosophy. Okay, so philosophy of life is there. So already that degree name is Doctor of Philosophy, whenever he's going for study in PhD. So we have to be very careful when I'm going for higher study. And we have to be not to get depressed in any level. Okay. So how to get rid of this? Many person is suggested these things. Not me, I am not testing this. So give yoga, meditation, go for exercise. Only exercise is treatment for the depression. Medicine cannot treat depression. Medicine, if you go after depression, you go to the, many person go to the doctor, they give medicine. Neurologists give medicine. So, but he cannot, that medicine cannot get rid. They cannot motivate you. Your motivation is from your inside. And that black dog will occupy you. It is not, cannot go out. Okay. So you have to make light mood in yourself. So you have to watch movie, you have to go theater, you have to go with friends, and you have to cook. If you know cooking, you not know cooking also, you try to cook. So you do some sports activity like that. So you have to be engaged in other works so that when you are depressed, you don't do that thing. Suppose I am going to lab in the morning or in the office in the morning, the traffic jam is there. So I cannot reach my office on time. So I get depressed. That should not be the way. We should think, yes, if I come on time, maybe there is some accident in the road. I avoid the accident because I am late. So that should be our approach. We can go up, or means we can go out early for the house. That is different issue. This hour, if suppose I go up out, suppose I go, now I have to go out 10 a.m., I go out 8 a.m. Still, I cannot reach on time. due to roadblock, etc. So we should not be depressed. There should be some reason for that I am late. We should be relaxed. Okay, whatever is going on is good for us. We can move our hand, we can talk, that we are thankful to God. Okay? Next is celebrate success, no matter how small is that. Suppose you publish an article in a newspaper, you probably write, I told that you can write anything to newspaper. You can write short story, you can talk, you can draw own blog, you can create in the internet, you can write anything, you can post your song, you can do anything. And that is, you share with your friends and celebrate it. So that will read you out from the depression. Then try new things as we are doing now. We are using Zoom for this meeting. We cannot present physically. So we are trying new things. Then there's a big and bright word after the PhD. We don't think that, yes, after the PhD, we will get a good job. I'll be the masterpiece. No. After PhD, after 3 years, what will happen? We don't know. Like now, many persons getting jobless. We don't know what is going to happen after 1 year. Even I did or not, we don't know. So whatever we're doing for the betterment of the society, and we're doing that for now. And we are doing for PhD, but we don't expect that PhD will give us result. We are definite. But we don't expect that this will be our result. I will score first in the class. No, not like that. If I think I will score first, I get second, I get depressed. My child will get depressed. So we should not be focused on like that. Okay, we should not go for rat race. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
okay.
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So whatever I'm telling, we should take life as a game, like a cricket ground. Every ball is coming to us, every ball we're trying to hit. But every ball we cannot hit six. Which ball we can hit six is the opportunity. Then I can get a job, I can get everything like that. But it does not mean that all one ball I miss, another ball will not come for six. Okay. Even whole match, I cannot make a six. I can make only one run. But that one run also important for the whole team. Clear? You cannot quit the ground without for that one run. Okay, I make one run. Other person opposite to my three is already 100, scoring century. No, it is a team spirit. Yes, he make 100 because I am here. I am making one run for him. I am here in the crease. Otherwise, he cannot run. He cannot run the show. The team will lose. So I am in the ground. And until I am in the ground, nobody can move me out. That is should be our motto. Okay. So we should be emotionally, we should think, and we have to deal with the stress, anxiety, and depression by our own means from the inside. We should be insidely strong. Yes, whatever we are doing right. Maybe he is doing more, there is no issue. He published for 8 papers, 10 papers, there is no issue for me. He getting higher post, he going higher ranking, no problem. Whatever I am, okay? So in this context, I must tell that Charles Darwin again, refer to Charles Darwin, every time I give lecture, I come to this slide. Struggle for existence, we are struggling. So we are getting depression, etc. But survival of the fittest. Who is fit, they will survive. Who is fit, he will stick on the crease. He will run the show and he will lead the team to win. Clear? And that who will win or not, that is not in our hand. That is decided by the nature. Who will keep? Human will stay or the small bacteria, virus will stay. One small mosquito, dengue, one virus inside the mosquito, killing people. One malaria, lot of people killed during the epidemic last time. Killed there. We cannot get rid of that one mosquito also. Okay. So nature will select who will be here, who will get job, who will not get job, who will get good research result, who will not get result. That is completely different issue. We should focus on our work. Whatever we are doing the good, and we should consult with our supervisor and etc. to get good guidance and do some good activity from yourself and try to overcome, not enter, means overcome, no. You don't allow to enter the depression in your life. Okay? Always the dog should be under your leg. Dog shadow should not come top of our body, like this picture, as I told. Okay? This shadow of dog, you can see this picture? The dog should not, shadow, should dog not leaving you. Remember, dog is always with you. Very obedient. He not leaving the depression. So, he should be under your leg. Not the dog is guarding you. Like this, shadow. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, now, finally, the thing is that we should tell that I am here to stay. Clear?
Yes, sir.
I am here to stay and we will not leave the ground.
Yes, sir.
And we will do something for the society. Thank you all. Thank you for giving your time to be present. Any questions from anybody?
Sir, is there any method or something like that so that the what is the depression percentage? By seeing anxiety, you have given a lot of examples that the anxiety, all this thing is there. But is there any mathematical model sort of thing so that what is the percentage, how one person is depressed and what may be the root failure cause can be analysis?
Yes, yes. There are different types of survey methods by the Psychology Neurological Society of World. You can see in the internet, there are psychologists know actually these are the, what are the conditions, etc. Means what are the survey forms, etc. Accordingly, we can make score. The doctors and psychologists, they make score.
Let me supplement you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Let me supplement you, sir. So there are not only methods but also machines. Yes. If you come to near Kolkata in Sambajar, there is a famous diagnostic center known as Sroboni. And in South Kolkata, besides the Novena Hall in Anwar Sar Road, there are lots of places where psychometry is done. Psychometry is a method where both machine and questionnaires are used to measure the different psychological state, and depression is one of the psychological states that could definitely be measured quantitatively and qualitatively. And just like ECG, the papers are coming out, and with that report, the psychologists provide medicines. They suggest medicine. So this is only to supplement, Dr. Poddar. Very sorry, but I had to supplement.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Because it is a part of psychology. It is a special area, vast area, that psychometry and psychology. So there is a psychological institute, national institute. There is a national level, international level, like WHO. There is a national mental health association, etc. Is there. So we have to, if we want to get assessed, we have to go to the psychologist. Not that we can personally assess ourselves.
And let me supplement one more, sir.
More or less depressed in anywhere, every corner of the life. We cannot assume, and we can overcome this by trying some our own things. Okay.
And let me supplement in one more way, sir. Just one line, because you are very busy. I'm not disturbing, but only supplementing. Depression could lead to lots of innovations. Just like if we go to the singer, famous singer Manna Dey, if we go to the different players, if we go to the different scientists, they have all discovered their best at the time of depression. Depression comes as a challenge to them. Depression comes as a challenge to all of us, and if we accept it, if we try to get out of...
Sir, good insight. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
We have challenged ourselves. we have challenged ourselves and we are trying to create every day something new. These workshops and Dr. Poddar's presentation is some kind of innovation which has come out of depression only. Just to keep you away, these type of workshops are having, and Dr. Poddar is a very valuable presentation is going on. So that is also kind of thing coming out of this depression. So only to supplement Dr. Poddar. And if anybody has anything to say or ask, you can ask Dr. Poddar.
Yes, sir. This one actually, this lecture previously I don't decide it. But as sir told, can you deliver one? If you can free or can deliver, I don't know, this topic I fix. So this is also coming out from the depression situation. Because I am depressed, so I when I talk with all of you, then I'm feeling relaxed. Okay, when I sharing my view with you. So you also try to share your views with your friends, with your colleagues, with your family members. Okay, and I think we can overcome the depression in our life and also overcome the depression situation, economically depression, these things. Okay, so any question more? Or if no question, then we can end the meeting.
There are some emerging issues coming out that lockdown is a part and depression is a sub part of it. So any researcher with the help of sir and with the help of other teachers, Professor Karungo was present in the last session. Lots of very good academicians are present. So you can interact. This is a platform to interact. And what will be the impact? Impact is another construct which is coming out of the depression. So impact of depression, you can take it in positive and negative way. And as sir advised, some good questionnaire may be prepared and some empirical study may be done on depression, because in psychology every day there is a research, empirical research on depression. But if you are from different fields, multidisciplinary work can be done by 2, 3, 4 researchers, and I will request Dr. Poddar to give a very good publication of it. If you present it in a proper way, formatted manner, and plagiarism checking and all that are checked, it will come out to be a very good publication. So lots of new emerging areas are coming out, and grateful to Dr. Poddar that these new things are also being discussed in the same platform. And not only the conventional some tools and instruments are being taught, different emerging areas are coming out. So we are much honored and grateful to Dr. Poddar. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. Just to add on, the last meeting, Dr. Kanungo was there, Professor Kanungo. He is a very, means PhD in telecommunication. In India, very few person have PhD in telecommunication. And he is heading the telecommunication department of the C.V. Raman Global University. And very eminent professor. And he usually take all the activities. He is more, more slim than me and asking me how to overcome depression. But he is not depressed at all. He can know, he is making exercise, he is making everything to the students like you are doing for NSS, etc. So he is also like that. Many activity in the S.V. Raman Global University he is doing. And all over the India, he is famous engineering from the background. He is that type of person. So just to share, as I told, that we are here to support you for your research work. Any publication related work, we can work together, and we will in the lineup. We are in the doing something, we are thinking about this. Sir also discussed with me, we are coming up with some books and etc. So, get touch with your supervisors and do something for the society, betterment of the society, so that we can achieve some goal in our life. Okay, and don't get depressed at all in our any branch, and we don't have to measure our depression. Anybody depressed, you give some good advice so they can get rid out of it. Thank you. Okay, everything.
So, lastly, sir, we can convert your words into something more. If I break your words, depression, depression. So, depression, D, starting with some dimension. So, we got new dimension from your lecture. So with this, very happy note, and everything, depression, depression, each of the letter has its meaning, but there is no time enough. So this new dimension is opened up by Dr. Poddar. So we again express our heartfelt gratitude and thanks to Dr. Poddar for his very timely and very enriched session. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for having being with us for the second time. And hope we'll get the same cooperation from you in near future. And our Indian researchers, as you are from Indian heritage, so Indian researchers, and let me tell you, not only sir, sir's elder brother, sir's father, more specifically sir's father. So they are having the heritage in research, not only the management research, but also health research, diagnostic research, medical research, everything. So Dr. Poddar's foundation, you know all, they are doing great for the society. So again, gratitude to Dr. Sandeep Poddar, Honorable Director, Research and Publication of Lincoln University, Kuala Lumpur, for his very valuable presentation. And also, he's a very good human being, sir. Thank you so much for being with us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all for joining
us. Thank you, sir.
So, with this ending the meeting today, thank you, sir. Thank you.
If anything, you can contact with me. No problem. Welcome.
Thank you, sir.